From the opinion pages of the Wall Street Journal, this is Potomac Watch.
The election battle over control of the United States Senate. That's our subject for today on Potomac Watch. And it's arguably as important as the fight for the White House. We will explain why. Welcome to Potomac Watch. I'm Paul Gigot, editor of the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal. And here today with Barton, Swaim and Faith Bottum, who have been covering the races in Wisconsin and Montana, two races that could determine the majority. First, a little context. Who controls the Senate will matter a great deal for how much the president can accomplish, including the confirmation of his or her nominees. And it's especially important if Democrats win the Senate as well as the House and the White House, because they're promising to break the Senate filibuster rule that would make many more policies possible to pass with 51 votes instead of the normal 60 or 50 plus Democratic votes and a Democratic vice president. So Democrats now control the Senate with 51 seats. They're all but certain to lose West Virginia, which is now held by Joe Manchin, who is retiring. That would make it 50-50. But there are about six toss-up seats this year in the Senate that will determine the majority, most five of them held by Democrats, the other by Rick Scott of Florida. And then there are five other races that either lean Democratic or Republican. Four of those are Democratic, one of those held by Ted Cruz in Texas. So the Democrats are at least a structural disadvantage this year in the Senate. But of course, Republicans got to win those seats. And let's focus, Faith, first on Montana, where you went recently and wrote about in our weekend edition. Tell us about the race between Tim Sheehy, the Republican challenger, and John Tester, the incumbent.
Yeah, well, Tim Sheehy's a fantastic candidate for Republicans in Montana this year. You know, he is a Navy SEAL. He has a bronze medal for heroism. He has a Purple Heart. He started his own forest firefighting company in Montana when he moved there. You know, he's young, he's lively, he's a good candidate for the state. And you have all these people coming out for Trump this year. A lot of working class voters that are going out for Trump are also probably going to come out for Sheehy. You have a lot of people moving, new people moving into the state.
That's one of the most interesting things that you wrote about, which is the changing demographics of Montana.
Yeah.
I mean, they've had Democratic senators and congressmen for years. It was known as a union state for many years.
Absolutely.
That's not the case any longer. Who's moving in?
Yeah, it's, you know, there's about 50,000 new people moving in since the pandemic. And these people, they seem to be, a lot of them seem to be young people. A lot of them seem to be coming from states such as California, Oregon, Washington, and they seem to be moving to a state that better reflects their values.
So these aren't just rich swells from Beverly Hills moving into...
Doesn't seem like it. Or if it is, they want a different change of pace.
They're moving there for a different kind of politics?
They are, yeah. And, you know, we've seen Montana's third largest city, Great Falls, lose its last Democratic legislator this past election.
State legislature. Yeah, mm-hmm. That's kind of amazing. So what is Sheehy running on?
Yeah, he's running a lot on national issues. I had the chance to interview him and he told me, you know, national issues are now local issues. So he's, you know, thinking a lot about the economy. He's focusing heavily on immigration. He's sort of asking the question again, are you better off now than you were 4 years ago? So it is very nationalized. It's, you know, do you care about the Senate is another point.
He's running on that?
Yeah, he is. He is. Yeah.
He said this could determine Senate control. Does he say that?
Yep, he does. And voters are starting to pay attention to that. His opponent, John Tester, wants this race to be local. You know, he wants it to be about abortion. He wants it to be about infrastructure issues, local hospitals and that kind of stuff. It'll be a very close race.
Abortion is a national issue, but it's also local in the sense that there's a referendum on the ballot.
Absolutely.
Right? Codifying close to Roe v. Wade.
Absolutely. It'll definitely bring out Democratic voters this year.
Okay. So basically, Tester, it sounds to me, is he's trying to avoid having to say, I endorse Kamala Harris.
Oh, absolutely.
I agree with the Biden agenda. I voted for 91% of the time.
Well, it's interesting because he is one of the people that recruited her to run for Senate way back when.
When he was running the Senate campaign committee.
Yeah, yes, correct.
For the Democrats.
And, you know, now he's conveniently skipped the DNC this year and he refuses to endorse Ms. Harris. It's quite something.
Who is that? I don't even know who she is.
Yeah.
And Sheehy's in the lead now, do you think?
I think it's going to be close. You know, in 2022, we predicted, you know, everyone was saying, oh, there's going to be a red wave. And so I think I'm just generally very suspicious now of any type of lead. But yes, Sheehy is ahead in the polls.
But Chuck Schumer, the Senate Democratic leader, is spending enormous sums of money, more than the Republicans on behalf of Tester.
Oh, sure. Yeah. No, I mean, this race, just in terms of ads alone, $240 million at least have been spent on just ads.
And how many people live in Montana?
Under a million, easily. It's the most expensive Senate race in history per vote now.
I mean, they don't have a lot of big media markets. So it just must be wall-to-wall ads.
Oh, yeah. No, you know, you go to a restaurant or a bar, you know, and you get an ad break. It'll be a Tester ad and then a Sheehy ad. You know, there are billboards all over the state. You turn on your TV, it's an ad. You turn get on your phone, it's an ad. I mean, you just really, it's inescapable being there. And I was only there for a couple of days and I was sick of it. I can't imagine how they feel.
I should add, you're a Westerner, South Dakotan, so you know the region. Barton, let's talk about Wisconsin, my old stomping ground. I love the state. Eric Hovda there, an entrepreneur running as a challenger against Tammy Baldwin, a Madison Democrat who's running for her third term. Tell us about that race.
Right. Well, in Wisconsin, as in a lot of these other battleground states, you would think that the Republicans would be set up for some easy wins. Inflation, the southern border, to some extent crime, the Afghanistan withdrawal and its consequences abroad, that hasn't gone away. You add to that Kamala Harris's basic non-response to almost all these issues. However, Democrats have two big issues, abortion and Donald Trump. And that's certainly true in Wisconsin. I don't think that abortion is the sure thing as an issue that Democrats think it is, but they do have an advantage when they can define the Republican as an extremist on the issue. In the case of Eric Hovde, what's hurting him most, I think, are some statements he made way back in 2012 when he ran for the Senate nomination. And he made statements like, I am 100% against abortion. Boy, has the Baldwin campaign used that. With Donald Trump as an issue, you can't really do anything about that. Hovde and other Republicans just have to hope that top of the ticket does well. But Hovde is hitting these issues as hard as he can and trying to win back some of those suburbs, especially in Milwaukee. But other than those two issues, abortion and Trump, he has two significant challenges. One is Baldwin isn't known for a lot. You could put that positively and say, well, she doesn't do a lot of television. She doesn't have a national brand and so on. Or you could put it the way Hovde does and other Republicans and say she doesn't do anything in Washington. Either way, there's just not a lot of material for Hovde to work with. She votes with a party virtually all the time, but otherwise she sponsored very few bills. She's not closely associated with really any legislative accomplishment. So you can portray her as a sort of do-nothing, but you can't tie her to any one thing. And the other challenge, as in Montana, is money. Baldwin and the Democrats have a lot of it, and they are spending it. Already, Baldwin has spent coming up on $30 million, and Hovde has spent about $13 million, much of that his own money. And just as in Montana and some of these other states, you go to Wisconsin right now, turn on your phone, open YouTube, turn on the television, and you will almost certainly see an attack ad against Hovde. Less frequently some of his ads, but it's a wall-to-wall ads all the time.
All right, we're going to take a break. And when we come back, we'll talk more about the race in Wisconsin when we come back. Welcome back. Here on Potomac Watch, I'm Paul Gigot with Faith Bottom and Barton Swaim. We're talking about the race for the Senate. It's really interesting when you go, as I do sometimes, often, three or four times a year, go back to Wisconsin. Everybody talks about Tammy, right? It's just Tammy. They know her as Tammy. That's about it. You couldn't tell them what else she has going for her other than the fact, yeah, she's from Madison, which, of course, is the hotbed of progressivism in the state. Yeah, she's a Democrat who votes for the Democrats. And I mean, that makes it hard. In a lot of these states, another race where Republicans have a hard time with this is Pennsylvania, where Dave McCormick's running against Senator Casey, who has not defined at all by anything other than the Casey name, which has a long and storied history in Pennsylvania because his father was governor.
That's exactly right. I spoke to some sort of on-the-ground activists doing polling and other things for the Republican in Wisconsin, and several of them described, you know, sort of door-to-door interactions in suburbs of Eau Claire and Milwaukee, and the person they talked to did not know who Tammy Baldwin was. which is sort of incredible. And certainly the ones who did know who she was couldn't say much about her. And it has been interesting to watch these polls. Wisconsin, especially in Ohio, Pennsylvania, you're now seeing a lot of these races start to tighten up. And I'm guessing, you know, Baldwin is the odds-on favorite, but I think it's going to be a nail-biter.
It's interesting. Unlike Montana, Trump is going to, he won by what, about 20 points?
Yeah, he'll at least win by 10 points this election.
Probably more than that. So that's an uphill fight for Tester. He's got to get ticket splitters. As the incumbent, he will get some, but can he get enough? Whereas in Wisconsin, it's going to be really, really close, Barton, in the presidential race. Certainly the polls suggest that. If Hovde wants to win, and he may have to outpoll Trump by some margin if it's another 20,000 vote spread in the presidential.
I think that's exactly right. He's running a smart campaign. Just watching him, I would say he has a lot of just natural talent, a lot of charm. He's an accomplished guy. The attacks against him are, I don't want to say tendentious, but he has a bank that's now headquartered in Salt Lake, and he's done a lot of stuff in California. So Baldwin is trying to portray him as sort of a carpetbagger of a kind. I don't think that's really landing with a lot of voters, especially because Hovde just sounds like a Wisconsinite when he talks.
Should I take that personally, Barton?
I would say he sounds more Wisconsin than you do.
You haven't heard me say Wisconsin.
You know, some of these sidebar attacks, I'm not sure how significant they are, but he is running a really strong campaign as well as I can tell.
The Hovde business is well known in Madison, in particular, Madison area. I mean, it's not as if this guy just had a bunch of businesses out of state and decided, oh, I look at Wisconsin and it sounds like a good state to run in. He's got a substantial business presence in the state.
That's right. And the problem with that is he's not going to do very well in Madison. So he's very well known there, but not elsewhere. I really think it's going to come down to the Milwaukee suburb where he's spending a lot of money and a lot of time.
That is Scott Walker country. The counties around Milwaukee, Waukesha, Washington, and Ozaukee counties, not Milwaukee proper, but those counties carried the state for Scott Walker when he ran for governor twice. But Donald Trump has trailed, not done as well as some of the down-ballot Republicans in those states, although they did help Ron Johnson win in 2022. And this is one of the curiosities about Wisconsin. And it's a rare state nowadays, Barton, in that it has the two senators are divided between the parties, one Republican, one Democrat. And not only that, but really a big ideological divide. I mean, Ron Johnson is one of the most conservative Republicans, and Tammy Baldwin is one of the most liberal Democrats.
Yep, that's it. Can I just add one more thing? I would say there's an issue that could make a big difference for Republicans in Wisconsin and elsewhere. October 7th is the one-year anniversary of the Hamas attacks on Israel. And you remember that many of us were sort of dumbfounded last year when these campuses exploded in sort of defending Hamas. It was shocking and kind of ugly before Israel even responded. There are going to be, I'm guessing, a lot of that ugliness again on October 7th, which is a month before the election. And so far, to my mind, the Democrats have not figured out a way to speak with clarity on this. So that's going to be an issue. You know, there were big protests at UW-Madison, in Ann Arbor, UPenn in Philadelphia. That's going to be an issue that if Republicans are prepared for it, they could really use to their advantage.
Is Tammy Baldwin even campaigning in the state at all? I mean, or is she just doing the TV thing?
A little. I was not able to see her. Based on advisories and so on, for the public, hardly any. I did get a couple of them across in my inbox last week. So apparently she's making some appearances there, but she is hard to find.
Yeah, so she's just trying to run on incumbency and tar Hovde with abortion and Donald J. Trump.